lot of built-in amplifier test benches that I don't have to reconfigure. I can just go ahead and open up one of these templates. The amplifier, this three-section amplifier, is in that big symbol in the middle with the three triangles on it. And I was able to run a series of simulations looking at different power sweeps, different gains, what the transient waveform would look like, gain flatness. And this is pretty much sort of your class A, class AB type of analysis. If I was so inclined to be looking for something more along the lines of just power gain, where I'm more interested in load pull contours, those templates have been predefined for me. I can easily bring in load pull contours, see what my device is doing, see what I'd want to match for, be it gain, power added efficiency, or power itself. A lot of these test benches have been set up for you, as well as being able to look at more complicated sweeps where, in this case, I'm varying my bias voltages and I'm looking at power contours and power added efficiency to get some idea of what would happen if the battery drooped or those bias voltages changed over the course of use of the amplifier. So depending on what style of design I'm using or what I'm particularly looking at, there are several different setups within the ADS environment for amplifier design already sitting there for you to use. So once the design was starting to look fairly reasonable from my standpoint, I wanted to go ahead and generate a layout, which I did. I moved this into our layout environment. I synchronized it from the schematic, generated my layout here to get an idea of what this would look like. At these frequencies, I just used very simple biasing techniques where I have a capacitor to ground, giving me a good short point, and then my line, the lower green lines or the blue lines on the north and the south, bring my bias in over a quarter wave. So now I'm using that, having a short at the capacitor point or at the via, and rotating that to the main line to be an open. And for me, this has traditionally been very, very effective for biasing, and we didn't have any oscillations. We'll see later in the measurement, so this seems to work pretty well once again. But this was just step one of getting the layout. What we're going to see next is, in cleaning it up a little bit, changing things around within the TQP13 PDK, we've implemented a personality toolbar, if you will, for Mimic here. And there's a lot of specialized techniques here for selecting, deselecting layout elements like transmission lines, converting them to different layers, inserting vias, chopping, changing things around. So I was able to quickly route over the poly on the input of the device and send the via down to a lower level metal and route and connect up my capacitor and my resistor. At this point, I could have run a male DRC, which is a DRC that I'm running on a TriQuint server in Oregon, and I'm going to take the necessary layout, send it to that server, have it checked on the TriQuint server, and then the results are going to be sent back to me. That's implemented directly on this toolbar. So I could have done it that way, or with the advent of ADS 2009, we've built our own integrated desktop DRC. TriQuint is currently into the working with Agilent. We're currently implementing the rules for these, and once we have that, we'll be able to, as we've done here, just point to a particular design rule deck, run the DRC engine on it locally, and get our results, view them, make any corrections we need to, and then once we have the corrections for our DRC, we would be able to invoke our desktop LVS engine, where we're now looking back between the layout itself and verifying that we still meet the schematic representation of that we haven't, and somehow altering or changing the layout for DRC completeness or cleanness, that we haven't modified our connectivity. So with it update 1 of 2009 ADS will have a complete front-to-back flow within the environment, able to find design differences, complete the DRC, and get a clean, ready-to-build layout, which is what we're seeing here now. So now we put it together with the launches, as you can see, so we can probe it on a prober station later on. We've done that. We can also, within the ADS environment, easily visualize what this looks like from the third dimension, to be able to look at how the vias are pushing through the dielectric, or just to see it from a different angle other than the standard 2D view looking down at it. From this, we generated a reticle cell for the fabrication process. As you can see, we put a few additional elements on there. We put the input and middle stage by itself, and the middle and output stage by themselves. We put some individual devices, as well as some calibration and matching structures that we're going to be needing later on when we go into test. Have a little bit of a close-up of what that feedback ended up looking like. This was kind of what we were looking for to really stabilize that device, if you remember, and it came out very similar to what we were first kind of looking at. But the first routing adjusted the lengths a little bit was really about all we did. So with the design being clean, from a DRC standpoint, LVS associated it back with the schematic. We knew we were ready to build. And we went ahead and went into the fab. And as you can see, we have the fabricated parts here. We have a three-stage amplifier in the TQP13 process. We fabricated those, as well as some of our standards here. So these are individual devices, one with and without the feedback, so we could check those individually. And we built some calibration standards because we're going to want to double check, even if we're not using these as our CAL standards. I like to be able to check. We have a via there for checking how our short's acting and open. We have a resistor and we have a through line in there as well. So these are just some of the CAL standards we ended up coming up with. We then mounted this on a metal test board that's gold flashed. We use conductive epoxy and parallel plate type capacitors that we bonded to. So on the north and the south, on the north we're going to have our drain voltage, which was about 4 volts. On the south, we have our gate on the south, which ended up optimally being about 0.7, 0.8 volts. Then on the left is our input, and on the right is our output. So once we're fixed it up, we're ready to go into to the lab, and we have a very nice Cascade Elite 300 prober that we have here with 4 probe heads on it. You can also see the PNA kind of hiding and buried in the middle of that in the background of the prober. So we use an Agilent PNA, obviously, to do our measurements. And here we're lining up on a particular device. We have a couple different variations of the amplifier itself, but actually the one we designed was sort of our nominal case that we designed for a 100 micron substrate thickness did work the best, reinforcing the specs for the process. So we're lining up on the device here, and then we're connecting it up with the probes and getting ready for test. So this was the test environment that we were testing under. And looking at our measurement results thus far, we have several more things to measure and more to be done. We can see that we actually measured, we were low in frequency. We were expecting around 60. We're actually working more around 52 gigahertz. But we are keeping a fair amount of power, considering we're not well matched in that range. Only about 6 or 7 dB return loss in that range was encouraging. So we're losing some power to mismatch loss, but we did end up being pretty low in frequency. Again, because of the time constraints, we had not had a chance to do a lot of additional modeling around it. But one of the first things we want to look at is well, we didn't pay attention to the actual layout from an EM standpoint, what might some critical areas be? Well, certainly we have that long stub, which could move us off a little bit in frequency, but probably more likely we're going to have an awful lot of coupling right in the where the device is mounted because of the via's close proximity to the lines. The way we have to air bridge into the device itself, we can't have a good solid line coming up so you can see the air bridge is coming into the device. So let's go ahead and just, to this point, we've looked mainly at just the first stage. So what is this? We run an EM simulation on this to get an idea of what this looks like from a 3D EM standpoint. Even though method of moments is a planar technique, we have extended the algorithm to understand metal thicknesses and couplings between metals, so we do understand vertical and horizontal sidewalls with on the planar structures. And again, this is completely integrated within our layout environment. We didn't go somewhere else. We just were able to take out the device and section out the piece of metal that we wanted to look at. We ran a simulation on it using method of moments. And then we took those results, the layout look-like element here, just so we can see where we're connecting up. We took that back into the schematic environment, and we're comparing it to our first stage of the amplifier that we actually built. And when we did this, we're able to see that that did, in fact, shift the frequency. And it shifted it just exactly to where we're seeing it right now. So we need to do the other stages, which will, I think we'll be sending out some sort of amendment to this, addendum to this this talk, so that you can see that doing EM on the entire amplifier, as I expect, should move it down to the 50 gigahertz range, get us the right gain back out. But also give us a position to where now we know where the amplifier is working at. Again, this is an ongoing project for us to test out a flow, so we're going to scale this up. I would think would be the first thing, just scaling from a standpoint of frequency, and then adjusting slightly if need be to get our gain back. This proves out or reinforces that knowing up front we really should have done some EM simulation, but often we know we have we're constrained by time. So given that we used the empirical models for the transmission lines, they really didn't turn out too bad, and I think considering we're looking at 60 gigahertz as our tune frequency, and we hit 52. So in addition to looking at the performance of the amplifier itself, we also wanted to look at it under the conditions here theoretically or with simulation, look at it under the WPAN signal. Agilent has a product called System View that integrates or is linked to ADS. And here we're developing wireless library standards. So we have a WPAN as well as other these high definition type signal standards implemented within the ADS environment. We have sources, we have test benches, we have the receiver, so we can set up a detailed signal that can be used even in ADS simulation or can actually be taken out to hardware and also used with Agilent test equipment.